Then I said to myself, stop saying, woe is me, and not, why not me? Stop looking at what you no longer should be eating and look at this whole universe of new foods that you can now learn about.
Life is all about relationships. Lovers, family, body, or money. How satisfied you are can be completely explained by how you relate to things around you. This is Sophie Jaffe, and together with my husband, Dr. Adi Jaffe, we are here to explore and teach you how to maximize your relationships and achieve a happier life. Let's get ignited.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to this episode of the Ignited Relationships Podcast. I'm Adi Jaffe.
And I'm Sophie Jaffe.
And Sophie, you just got back from Mexico.
Yes, I was in Cabo with the kiddos. Two of the three. We couldn't get Kai's passport in time, unfortunately.
It was very depressing.
Yeah. So in case anyone's wanting to travel, you just a little something, something. You cannot travel with a passport that is expiring within 6 months. So his was expiring in December. It's October right now. So it was really unfortunate. We had to kind of leave him behind.
He was not happy about that, especially as you guys shared stories of Leo jumping from a trampoline on the ocean into the ocean.
How would he have seen that? He doesn't have a social media account. Were you showing him? Are you trying to like dig the knife into his back?
I was looking at your stories and he was like, what is that?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Let's try and like not show
Sophie
him that.
Sophie always asked me to look at her stories and now I'm looking at
Please
her stories.
Please don't show that to our child who's been left behind. That's all.
He just asked what I was watching.
Anyway,
what do you want from me?
Anyways.
I try not to hold back for my kids.
Uh-huh. Radical transparency. So I win. And it's, you know, it's interesting. A lot comes up around travel right now and, you know, judgments of the world and my own. I've had a lot of kind of as someone who shares publicly so much of what I do, I share, you know, like in the grand scheme of things, it's just a few minutes of my day on stories and on social media. But when you really think about it, like I'm sharing intimate moments of our lives on social media, on this podcast, going deep, being vulnerable. That's really what our message is to tell the full truth. So I don't want to share parts of my life or hide back parts of my life because I'm afraid of what people will think. And through this pandemic, I've noticed myself, I don't know if anyone can relate to this, but I've noticed myself holding back parts of my joy and parts of my happiness. And then actually going into more of a depression because I'm having to hold back my joy because I feel bad that I'm experiencing happiness when a lot of the world is suffering. So I want to share that openly here just because this trip was amazing.
You definitely were like, I mean, from this viewpoint here, you guys were sharing this time. Did you feel like you were able to let that go?
So I think over the last few months, well, we went to Tulum in July and then we went back to Cabo for Rochelle's engagement. And I really, that time, I did some healing. I actually worked with Jenna, who's been one of our guests and one of our dear friends from Human Design, a past guest. And she really helped me tune into that and that vibration of not feeling guilt, that doesn't help anything. Feeling guilt about your joy helps nothing in the world. But how can I really kind of still share and feel vulnerable, but even out that feeling of guilt. So for me, it's about giving back. And we talked about how to kind of make peace with the fact that I am in a joyful place when I am. And of course, I go through the normal ebbs and flows of life, but I am in a joyful place. I'm in a beautiful relationship and marriage, which wasn't always like that. I have beautiful, healthy kids and I have great opportunities. I'm also not sick with COVID, you know, like we actually are not suffering financially. And there are parts of that that I feel guilty about. And that's not helping the world. When people come to me for inspiration, it doesn't help anyone to have a watered down version of who I am because I can give people hope. And so I want to share that, yes, I was in Mexico last week and I was working. I've been working on and off with Four Seasons for 6 years now, planting these seeds, kind of trying to get myself seen and heard and start teaching for them. And so for this to come to fruition was a really cool thing. And then, as you know, that my superfood company philosophy has been 10 years now of really trying to help it grow and be nourished. So I've been really reflecting on this past weekend and how big that is for me personally and this growth. And although it's like slowly, it's slow and steady wins the race, right? And that's really what kind of my looking back on and reflecting on this weekend is like, oh, like that was a huge moment for me. So I missed you there. And that's why you recorded this solo as I was away.
Yeah, you were away. I was working all weekend too, not on a beach in Cabo though.
No, but you were doing something very cool.
In our living room, our house transformed into a studio. We completely reworked the Hero program. I shot like 25 hours of video content over 3 days. I talked so much. I took a day off talking the next day. But it was an amazing project.
I'm so excited to see this. This is a long time coming.
We've been talking about this for a year, planning it for like 4 months, and now it happened. So you guys were out of the house. Kai and I were here. It was a project for sure. And both of those got to get done in the same weekend, which was kind of crazy how that just worked out, which is amazing. But we're very happy to have you back. And while you were gone, I got to talk to Eric Adams, who, first of all, I got to say, the fact that I got on the phone with the president of Brooklyn, I'm kind of down just to say, like, can I put that on my resume now?
Right?
Like, had a full-on conversation with the president of the Brooklyn borough. This guy's a politician there. He does incredible work serving that population. Mm. Such a diverse crowd. He talks about that as well. What we started out the conversation around was he got diagnosed as being diabetic, type 2 diabetes, and cured himself by going on a vegan diet after the best doctors of New York laid out for him this idea of this nightmare of what his life was going to look like, cured it, wrote a book about it, trying to get other people to change. And now he's trying to get people in Brooklyn, including hospitals, to change the food that they provide. So I told him how you and I have been talking about that for years and years. So beautiful to have somebody do this. We got into so many different sides of the equation, talking about education and healthcare for people in general. And then because Eric is a black politician in Brooklyn, I couldn't let go of the part of the conversation of what are we doing about public safety and those aspects. Since we talked about that in the end, such an incredible guy. It was really, really an amazing conversation. I'm so proud that we got him on this because the work he's doing, not just to change health habits around him, but just to get people to rise and sort of see outside of the accepted norms of what they think is possible for them, is really amazing. And Eric, just good on you, man, for doing all this.
I cannot wait
work.
To listen to this. Yeah. Yay.
Enjoy.
This episode of the Ignited Podcast is brought to you by Philosophy Superfoods. The Philosophy offers cleanses and other nutritional products that are unlike any of the other supplements and detoxification programs on the market. Why? Because they actually nourish the body with whole, live, nutrient-rich foods instead of depriving you and leaving you hungry. Have you ever tried a cleanse only to find out that you can't make it through a whole day because you're starving? Ever try a superfood shake that made you nauseous because it was so disgusting you'd rather not eat? The Philosophy fix all that with a simple set of offerings that load up your body with nutrients while actually tasting good. Makes sense, right? Each of the Philosophy superfood and protein blends is vegan, raw, gluten-free, and has absolutely no filler ingredients. With over 15,000 satisfied customers, including some of the world's biggest celebrities like George Clooney, Gerard Butler, Lea Michele, and over 10 years of experience, this is the best stuff you can get. To buy some or find out more info, go to our website, thephilosophy.com.
All right, everybody. Welcome back to the conversation part of today's episode. We are honored to have Eric Adams here with us today, Borough President of Brooklyn. I love it. I love your story. There's so many different aspects to what you've done around your health journey and what you've accomplished since then that really relate not just to the work that I do primarily with people who struggle with addiction, but also to my own personal experience. And maybe I want to start out with a piece of what you've done, and then we'll go back a little bit to look back at it. Well, I know one of the big missions that you have right now is changing the way food and nutrition is managed within the healthcare system, and you're doing that locally. And I've got to tell you, I mean, Sophie and I have been talking about this. My wife has been talking about this for 15, 20 years, just how absurd the idea is that we go to take care of people and then we load them up with the exact same stuff that's been making them sick on the outside.
Right.
The reason it's personal for me is my dad ended up dying of cancer, and we'd sit in the hospital going, I don't understand how this food is the food they're feeding somebody while they're giving them these medications that are already really, really difficult for them to deal with. And, you know, he ended up not making it. And I always wonder about the role of nutrition for that. So I know you've got a whole journey. I want you to tell our people about that work that you're doing, but also how you got to be interested in that work.
Yeah, no, so true. And I'm looking at the poster you have in your office, Why Not Go Out on a Limb? People often think about that, and it's like leaving our comfort space to find really, I think, our real purpose when you go out on a limb. You know, it's frightening, it's scary. We're leaving the ground that's familiar to us, but it is really out on a limb that we find, you know, that is which is waiting for us.
Yes.
And that's what happened, you know, just to give you a quick synopsis of, you know, almost 4.5 years ago, I was just talking to my doctor a little while ago. We were reflecting of when I walked into his office and I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, experiencing vision loss, permanent nerve damage in my hands and feet, the constant tingling, neuropathic nerve damage that they said, and they said it was permanent. The high blood pressure, high cholesterol, I had an ulcer, and that was really the driving force to get me in the doctor in the first place, because I thought it was colon cancer, because I lost a good friend at 50 to colon cancer. And just really being in the comfort of not really thinking differently. And I went to 5 of the best doctors in the city. As the county executive, I had access to the presidents of hospitals who said, listen, we're going to send you to our best endocrinologist and let's try to help. And they all told me the same thing. Eric, is hereditary. You're going to be on medicine the rest of your life. You're going to eventually lose your sight, or you may lose some fingers and some toes.
Wow.
This is the journey that you're on. This is your new norm. Insulin, metformin, medicine for your ulcer, your blood pressure, high cholesterol, your drops or your vision loss. It was just, you know, the whole package. And just, you know, going out on a limb, sitting down at that computer that day after all of those visits. And my limb was, instead of typing living with diabetes, I typed one different word, reversing diabetes. And that took me on another trajectory.
You had to believe in some way that there was something out there that would go against that advice, even though you kept getting it from all the same people. You're like, I know there's something out there that's different.
And you know, that when you really think about that, that is just something amazing about the human experience. Because our bodies and our makeup, our psyche, only knows truth. The problem is because we evolve into adulthood, we have been bombarded with what we can't do instead of allowing our bodies and our spirits to speak to us. And it would tell us the truth. We just need to sit our asses still sometime and just listen to our souls. It would tell us the truth because program into our DNA, those strands, those X's and Y's, is really the wisdom that has been on this planet forever. And so inside me, when I sat still for a moment at my computer, it was telling me, no, there's something else. And you just got to listen sometimes and get away from the distraction. And so it started me on the journey of meeting great doctors who thought differently. And I was able to turn around that terrible prognosis. And 3 weeks after changing my diet, going to a whole food plant-based diet, my vision returned. 3 months, my diabetes went in remission. My nerve damage went away. The ulcer went away. The blood pressure normalized. My 80-year-old mother who was diabetic for 15 years, 7 years on insulin. She joined me, and mom also was able to reverse her, get off her insulin. And that's what my book, Healthy at Last, is about. It's just a real conversation, not talking down to people, at people, but just letting them know that this ordinary person was able to find that we don't have to be unhealthy.
Mm. I love so many pieces of that, especially that you ended it with this ordinary person, because it's true in so many ways, right? We can all do this. And yet there's all this pressure from outside to just stay in line. And it's about everything, right? Like, why do we eat the food that's most convenient rather than the food that's the cleanest and best for us? It's just easier. But why is it easier? It's easier because we're stressed out and busy with all the other stuff all the time. And so we're running around like chickens with our heads cut off. And when it comes time to take care of ourselves, we don't. We just pop something in the microwave, heat it for 45 seconds, saying, hey, I got my meal in, I'm good. And what we don't realize is that as we're doing that, we're building up these other problems we're going to have to deal with. And so you can run around and be busy. And whether you're making money, you're making a difference in the world, those things matter. It's not that they don't matter. But if you don't take care of yourself, what might seem like convenience when you're 20, 25, 30, then becomes these big, massive problems. And I love hearing how quickly this changed for you when you flipped.
No, so true. And it's amazing when you think about it, and I think you are dead on when you talk about, you know, how we really put other things ahead of the most important thing, and that's our health. I'll never forget my son saying to me when I was diagnosed with diabetes and I went on his journey, he says, Dad, I watch you go from service station to service station, putting the best oil in your BMW. You weren't putting the best food in your body. You know, like, we worried about our suits, our ties, our shoes, our bags, our houses, our cars. All those things are so insignificant. If you have to roll in your wheelchair because you lost your feet to diabetes and you can't drive that Ferrari, what good is it? If you lose your sight, which diabetes is the number one cause of blindness, and you can't see the house that you bought, what good is it? So we have to ask ourselves and rethink what are we doing to ourselves that we're so external that we're not even looking internally.
So true. And, you know, the crazy thing, I didn't mention this before, but my dad was a physician. He was a doctor. And strangely, sometimes the people whose task it is to help, for some reason, this stuff hasn't entered the general conversation around healthcare. We still live in a, especially in this country, but in a world where we deal with problems instead of doing the work ahead of time to prevent them. And I'm so happy to hear that, again, there was this really quick turnaround for you. It's just magical and powerful. People sometimes think, well, maybe I could have done this. Maybe I could have switched my diet before and I would have prevented this from happening. But now that I've been diagnosed as diabetic, now I'm screwed. It doesn't matter anymore.
Right. And it's so unfortunate. I think that folks like your dad and other medical professionals, I think it's a Shakespearean tragedy of here these individuals that grow up all their lives to save the lives of people. They practice as children on their pets and their siblings, hoping one day to do this great noble profession of medicine in the spirit of Hippocrates, and just to go into an institution that destroys wellness and just give you these hiding symptoms instead of really empowering healthcare professionals with how to reverse diseases. You know, heart diseases, diabetes, high blood pressure. You know, people should have choices. And I think personally, I say this over and over again, I think doctors are going through PTSD every day, every year, watching their patients go into this slow decline, watching families destroyed, telling people over and over again that, you know, you're going to lose your sight, you're going to lose your fingers and toes. You know, knowing that they're not going to get better, even when they give them the metformin, the statin, that has to play on you, you know, after you do it over and over again.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And you mentioned all these other conditions, and the work that I do oftentimes is around addiction. And addiction is often compared to, they talk about it as this chronic relapsing disease like diabetes, cancer, hypertension, mm-hmm. and things like that. And I've literally used this example before. I said, they're lying to you even about the diabetes and the cancer. They're pretending like these conditions are irreversible. But let's be clear, you can be pre-diabetic and with a quick change in diet and some exercise and movement, completely kick it. But what you've shown is you can be diagnosed a full type 2 diabetic and reverse it relatively quickly. But, you know, I mean, look, some of the changes you made might seem extreme to people, but they're a lot less extreme than losing a limb or losing your eyesight.
Well said. Well said. I say all the time, either you give up that turkey leg or you give up your leg. You know, you make the decision, you know, what you want to do. But you're right. And I'm so glad you said that, because there is a feeling. I know when I started that first week, I felt as I was a person hooked on heroin. I dreamt about food. I thought about it. I would wake up in the middle of the night yearning for, you know, the pastry. And I realized that, you know what, Eric, you are addicted. You know, you're no different than a person addicted to heroin or alcohol. And I had to lean into this thought I had that this is too, just really so far to give up these things that I have known for over 54 years. But then I said to myself, stop saying, woe is me, and not, why not me? Stop looking at what you no longer should be eating and look at this whole universe of new foods that you can now learn about. It was a re-emerging. And when I did an analysis, I was only eating 7 or 8 things throughout the whole week prior to making a conversion. I was having 2 eggs on a roll with bacon or sausage every morning. I was having, you know, my slice of pizza, and, you know, dinner I would have a steak or something. So I was eating the same things. Now I have a repertoire of over 60 different meals that I've tried and I've learned how to cook. And wow. I'm just exploring a new place. And that's why I believe the part of my book, Healthy at Last, the most important part is the recipe. Those recipes are showing people, before you start having your own predisposition of what going healthy is about, check out the foods you can eat.
So true. There's actually a huge change. So my wife was vegan when I met her and is still primarily plant-based, like 85, 90% plant-based, and has been most of her life. That was a big change for me. I was a junk food eater before I met her. And so I'm not vegan, but I've gone substantially healthier, A, in the choices even of the meats that I eat, but also in really almost eliminating packaged foods and eating whole foods and things like that. But you said something I want to stress to everybody, because this is important no matter what you're struggling with right now in life. We just finished recording a brand new program for our people who struggle with addiction. And there was this quote that I put in there, and you just said it so succinctly. Too many people are afraid of change because they keep focusing on all the things they won't have anymore or the things they have to give up. And they don't focus on all the incredible things they're going to gain as a result of the change. And it's such a quick shift in perspective, right? The difference between saying, man, how am I going to give up my steak or my turkey leg or that, you know, that sausage and egg McMuffin in the morning versus how am I going to gain 15, 20 more years of healthy living? It's literally, yes. It's just what do you decide to focus on? And I think it's a great point that you make. I mean, I'm sure you see this in your role as a politician. People, we have this internal fear response, and so many times we're afraid of change. We're afraid of risk. And so anything that's different, people lock into everything they might lose, everything that might not be the same, and they forget all of the incredible potential that exact same change could produce for them.
Oh, so true. Well said. And I think you also pointed out what I hope people see in my book is that find your space. Don't find Eric's space. Find your space. Find your modifications. Find how you evolve. You know, I'm just using my life as an example for people to have a foundational understanding of the possibilities, but they should find their space. It may be that, listen, I want to go and be meatless 2 days a week or 3 days a week, or I want to, instead of using this, I'm going to use that. Find your space, and eventually we all start to go from crawling to walking to running and full understanding. And second, which is so important, this is not about trying to break the contract we have with the creator that we're all of a sudden going to reach the level of immortality. We're mortal. We're going to transition from the physical to the spiritual, no matter who we are. We're talking about quality of life, being able to enjoy a healthy sexual relationship with your loved one so that you're not dealing with ED because the arteries in your sexual organ is clogged and you have to deal with that. Being able to enjoy your grandkids. What's the purpose of living to be 90 and you can't even identify your grandkids because your brain's cells have been, your arteries and blood vessels in your brains is dealing with dementia and Alzheimer's, as the studies are showing, that's connected to food. Or going on vacations and wanting to be able to climb Machu Picchu without having to worry about your heart giving out. So I'm talking quality of life. I love the qualitative life I'm living because I decided to give up on those things that were interfering with the quality of my life. And it would have substantially destroyed that qualitative life if I would have lost my sight, lost limbs, had some of the other issues that are, you know, that are attributed to bad health choices.
100%. So, so true. Yeah. I talk a lot about how, you know, when I used to eat anything, I didn't look at labels. I didn't really care. I look for some really basic things. You mentioned we all have our route, and I want to talk about the book and some of your project here in a second. You know, I limit added sugar. That's like a simple one for me. I used to eat and drink so much sugar. It's insane. If somebody take some of the cereals you guys are eating at home and look at how much sugar is in them, and then recognize that that's for one cup, and most of us eat a bowl, not a cup of cereal. Right. So now double or triple that, and then measure that out in sugar. That was a really big experiment for me, is to really look at how much refined sugar we're getting, and so much, and then we wonder why we become diabetic. It's like we have flooded our bodies with fake nutrition, and right, our body reacts by saying, hey, stop. And we don't figure it out. We don't figure it out over and over. So that was a huge one for me, just literally reducing how much sugar I take in.
And you're right. And that is why part of what we are pushing to do in our schools is to teach our children how to read labels. You know, yes, it's amazing. We pick those items up off the counters or off the shelves in our supermarkets. We want people now to consciously start looking at labels and become knowledgeable about what they are consuming.
I love it. I love it. So tell us more. I mean, you're in this unique position, right? A lot of people I talk to may have had this experience, may have changed, may have maybe grew up this way their whole life and have been preaching it. But you're in a position where you actually get to impact individual lives and the lives of an entire borough. I want to hear more about what you're doing to change what's happening in your city.
Well, we are extremely excited. My Brooklyn Borough President is probably equivalent to many people know in their local municipalities as the county executive. New York City has 5 boroughs. Brooklyn is the largest with 3.6 million people. 47% of them speak a language other than English at home. So we're extremely diverse. And my goal here and my role is to implement policies through legislation or direct actions. And so we have several different initiatives we're doing here in Brooklyn that has cascaded throughout the entire city. One of them I'm extremely proud of is we have what's called a Meatless Monday initiative that we're really having our hospitals, our schools, other places where government feed people. We're actually showing that we could have healthier diets by really decreasing the amount of meat that we are serving people. As you pointed out, how do you sit in a hospital being treated for serious diabetic issues and you're being fed food that aggravates those same issues.
Cheeseburgers, literally like a cheeseburger for lunch while you're getting your insulin. It's crazy.
it really is when you think about it. And so I'm a big believer that I can't tell a person what to put on their grill in their backyard, but taxpayers' dollars should not go to feeding crises. And that's what we're literally doing right now. And so another amazing program we have is in Bellevue Hospital. Bellevue Hospital is the oldest hospital in America, the first hospital. We have the first of its kind lifestyle medicine clinic where we are reversing the diseases of people, showing people how to have lifestyle changes to impact their health outcomes.
I love it, man. You know, again, it's so empowering to see, just to see people who can have the impact. You know, again, right, this is not necessarily the easiest choice. I guarantee not everybody jumping up and down. You've got constituents who probably look at this as saying, well, why is the government interfering in what I can do and what I can't do? And I've said this for a while, and I actually wonder how you feel about this being in the middle of the system. Regardless of people's political leanings, I don't understand sometimes how we get away from the place that, sure, government's job is partially to take care of logistics and our infrastructure, right? Like pave the roads, et cetera. But outside of that, safety, health, and education seem to me to just be the cornerstones. We need to leave this place in America where any one of those three things is a privilege. You know, forget about the paying in the taxes. Yes, the paying in the taxes helps it. But if you're in our country, if you're with us, taking care of people's health seems to me like a no-brainer. Educating people seems, again, like a no-brainer. And obviously people are, unfortunately, so concerned with safety that most of our money ends up going to that. But, you know, when people are not taken care of educationally and when they're not taken care of in terms of their health, people get desperate. And of course they do, right? If my family is sick and somebody needs care, I'm going to do whatever I can to get them what they need. And I really hope, again, I want to hear how you feel about this, but I really hope we move to this place in this country where at least at a basic level, each one of those three things is just understood to be part of what you get as the package deal of being an American.
No, you said it right. And I always use the acronym SHE and what you just said, safety, health, education. It's so important and it should be a right. Not a luxury, not if you are fortunate to have it. It should be a right. All of us should be safe. I think public safety is a prerequisite to prosperity. We must be able to raise our families in a safe environment. And then you have to be healthy in the process. Nothing would impact your life more than being traumatized with a health crisis. It hijacks your life. It impacts your productivity. It really makes the family go through a very troubling period of time. When you think about a loved one, a child, a family member, a parent going through a healthcare crisis, it just sucks everyone into it. And of course, education. And we need to redefine what education is and looks like. It should be how do we develop our full personhood? How do we learn how to read labels, understanding nutrition? How do we learn internal moments, meditation, mindfulness, yoga? How do we empower people with long-term skills so they can live a better quality life? We don't do that now. We are having our children inherit everything from statin to other drugs to deal with emotional trauma, to alcoholism. We are creating an environment instead of producing a healthy future generation. We're giving them all the poor things that has destroyed the generation we're living now.
Amen. Amen. We've talked a lot at Ignited over the last, I don't know, now 4 months, however long it's been, too long, but we've only been talking about it really heavily for the last 4 months. And we talked about safety and public safety and that concept. I have to imagine that the climate in America right now, as it stands, is something that is on your plate and on your calendar and you know, somewhere top in your projects list here for a while. Because when we talk about safety, I can't ignore the fact that
you know, some people in communities around America have been safer than others for decades and centuries. And it feels to me like something is changing. It feels to me like there's more pressure and there's more of a broad understanding that it can't stay that way. You can't only keep a subset of the population safe and hurt other people regularly. I'd love to get something from you, because again, this is front and center for you. You have to actually deal with it in the real world. I get to just talk about it.
And that's a great point. And the mere fact you acknowledge that, I think we're moving to a good place in America, that their goals, there go you, go I. You know, we are connected. I'm a big believer that we are coming from the same universal center, and I cannot do something to you that won't impact me. I was a former law enforcement officer. I served 22 years in the police department before retiring as a captain. And I have witnessed how families have been devastated and destroyed due to the overproliferation of handguns, gun violence, what has taken place in our country. And it has torn apart communities. And even when the bullets have struck the physical body, it continues to emotionally travel and rip apart the anatomy of our community. And it's imperative that we create an environment where innocent people are not dying to violence in a real way, not in just some neighborhood, but in all neighborhoods. And so you're right, you're dead on. And we need to all lift our voices to state that we all need to be safe, because the lack of safety to one family is an impact on safety to all families.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for that. Again, I mean, I really hope that part of the conversation doesn't die out. It's, I knew it was an issue for a while, and I don't know, in whatever ways, it saddens me to know that it's only this recently that it's become so pressing that it seems like we have to do something about it. There's no other option. Thank you so much. I know your time is short. I know you got a lot to do. Eric Adams, thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
We'll have a link to your book, and would love to keep hearing about some of these things and projects you're putting in place, because hopefully that's a model for other places in the U.S. to just change the mode of operations and get their citizens healthier, safer, and better taken care of.
Thank you. I'll see you out on the limb together.
Thank you so much for coming.
All right. Be well.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everybody, for listening to the Ignited Podcast. We are so happy to have you along for this ride. Please go and subscribe to this. Leave us a review. We love hearing from you. And if you want more, don't forget to go to ignited.com, where all the podcast episodes are available, with show notes and so many of the little details and links from each one of these interviews. And you can look at all the future events that we have going on, all the things that make Ignited so special, even beyond this recording. Again, thank you so much for joining us. We will see you next week.